All right, well, welcome to Bible Mine, and we are going head-to-head against the Super Bowl, right? I told you I wasn't afraid. So here we are. We're gonna tackle some good stuff tonight, and we started our conversation about John Calvin, and so we're going to continue that and get into a discussion about predestination. We're going to take this in a couple of bites, and I'll explain that later. But John was a bright kid, just kind of recapping what we talked about last time. He was a bright kid and was selected to be groomed as a priest. And so his father at some point intervened and decided, you know what, I think it'd be better if you would be a lawyer than a priest. And so it kind of set him on that track of becoming a lawyer. While at university, he had some encounters which turned him toward the Reformation. So sometime between 1529 and 1533, he embraced the Reformed theology and turned from his Catholic roots and embraced the Reformed movement. He had a friend named Nicholas Kopp, and they were colleagues at a college. And Nicholas Kopp had received a position of being the rector at this university. And so he gets up in his inaugural address to the college, to the university. He gets up and he makes this address, and as people were listening to him, they realized that he was really making a speech and making a case for Reformed theology, just like right off the bat. Now, this was a secular college, but really in that day, most people were of the Catholic mindset. So even though it was a secular university, the people in the audience were more of Catholic persuasion. And so they got angrier and angrier. And as the speech went on, and apparently Nicholas Kopp was prepared for the reaction because he had a getaway horse behind the stage and was able to get on it and get out of town. And since John Calvin was a good friend and colleague of Nicholas Kopp, it was guilty by association, and John Calvin had to flee as well. So he moves around quite a bit and decides to head over to Strasbourg to pursue his writing career there. And he stopped over at Geneva, maybe just overnight or a couple of nights or something on his way. And while he was there, William Farrell begged him and persuaded him to stay in Geneva, even against his will, but kind of shamed him into it to where, you know, he's like, well, you know, I better stay or I'm going to be a dirty, rotten dog or whatever. And so, and we talked about that more last time. Just a few months after Calvin agreed to stay in Geneva at the begging of William Farrell, a significant event took place which highlighted the genius of John Calvin. And this was a significant event. In Switzerland, each city or province got to choose whether they were going to be Reformed or whether they were going to be Catholic. And then everybody had to be the same. You didn't have, like, we have, you know, church here, 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 and they're all different denominations. Either the whole city was going to be Reformed or the whole city was going to be Catholic. And so the city council had to choose. And so there was a city, that Lausanne, that was in this position of trying to choose. And so they were going to bring in some Catholic teachers or Catholic monks, and then they were going to bring in some Reformed, and they were just going to have a big debate, and whoever wins, they were going to pick, okay, you know, we're going to go this direction. And so this was in 1536. It's called the Lausanne Disputation of 1536. And so all these people came in, and William Farrell and this guy named Pierre Verret was invited to come in and make the case for the Reformed movement. And so they were gonna be the ones that were gonna make the presentation for this. So they were selected to come down and make the Reformed case. Farrell talked to Calvin and said, "Hey, you know, I want you to come with me." And so they brought him. What's that? Oh, well, you know, this is the same kind of hat that John Calvin wore a lot, too, if you'd notice in a lot of his pictures. So I think it's kind of like the university scholastic professor kind of hat or whatever. So it keeps your ears warm, too, I believe. So, but anyway, so Farrell talked to Calvin and talked him into going to this big meeting or big debate. And so Farrell offered 10 articles, which is now referred to as the Lausanne Articles, in a sermon which he had laid out the substance and the structure of the discussion. And so this kind of set the stage for this big debate that they were going to have. The exchange and debate ensued, and for some 3 days, the Catholics, really, they kind of won the day. They were better prepared. The Catholic monks seemed to have the better argument, and they seemed to be a little stronger in the way that they were making their presentation. And so Farrell, he kept like ribbing Calvin, is like, come on, man, we need some help. You know, why don't you stand up and say anything? And Calvin was like, you know, we've talked about this. You know, John Calvin, he didn't really want to be in the spotlight. He just wanted to write from the closet and send out stuff, you know. And so it's like, y'all are doing fine. You know, just keep doing what you're, what's that? Finally, on day four, the opposition made a really strong case, and they started making accusations against the people that are Reformed, saying that they had no respect or no regard from the church fathers. And so Farrell and Verrett, they kind of looked at each other and, okay, how are we going to respond to this? And so Farrell, he was just about to stand up, and John Calvin jumped up. He had had all he could take, I guess. And so he gets up, and he says something like this. He says, too bad you don't know more about the church fathers. Certain references could be of benefit to you. And he laid out three questions, and we won't go into all of that, but he poses three questions that the questions were so deep that the answers to those questions from the Catholic side kind of fell flat. And they kind of realized that we don't really have an answer for this. And so John, realizing that he had them back on their heels, he made a one-hour presentation with no notes, quoting scriptures, quoting church fathers, and I mean, for an hour, they just listened to him go. And when he was through, he sits down, and the place is quiet. Nobody wanted to say anything, not even the person that had levied the accusation in the first place. They were just like, we're done here. There was a Franciscan friar named John Tandy that he was a noted as a capable preacher who had denounced the Reformers from his pulpit. He spoke these words. This is written down later by him. He recorded this. It says, it seems to me that the sin against the Spirit, which the Scriptures speak of, is the stubbornness which rebels against manifest truth. In accordance with that which I have heard, I confess to be guilty. Because of ignorance, I have lived in error, and I have spread the wrong teaching. I ask God's pardon for everything I have said and done against His honor, and I ask the pardon of all of you people for the offense which I gave with my preaching up until now. I defrocked myself, something you don't hear every day, and that just means he gives up his position as a friar, to follow Christ and His pure doctrine alone. And so, I mean, that's the power of the words that John Calvin spoke in this 1 hour. I dare not read the 1 hour speech to you tonight. So. but it was quite persuasive. Okay, so he goes back to Geneva. And John remained in Geneva for 2 years, and it was the most miserable 2 years of his life. He hated every minute of it. The Libertines, if you remember who the Libertines were that we talked about, you know, they were the ones that they believed that because of freedom in Christ, you could do anything you wanted. And as a matter of fact, not only could you do anything you wanted, you should do as much as you can to show that you're free in Christ. So drink all you want, be immoral sexually all that you want, do all this stuff to show that you're a good Christian. And so John Calvin, he wasn't about that, you know. So the more he preached morality, the more that they pushed back against him and the more problems they gave him. And he became the butt of all the jokes, and he was ridiculed openly. There was one occasion that he was walking down the street and a chamber pot was thrown out on him. I mean, it was just horrible. He hated it in Geneva. Well, Farrell and Calvin, they continued to work with the city council on reforms. And Farrell drafted what's called a Confession of Faith, and Calvin wrote separate articles reorganizing the church in Geneva. And the city adopted a lot of these articles, and tried to put them into practice, but they had trouble enforcing them, and so not a lot was really done. And so as the year progressed, Calvin and Farrell's reputation with the council started to begin to suffer a little bit. They started having less and less influence. A standoff erupted on whether to use unleavened bread for the Eucharist. And so the council ordered Calvin and Farrell to use unleavened bread for the Easter Eucharist, and they protested and decided to refuse to do that. They were siding with, you should use, do y'all remember, we talked about this before, do you remember why there was even an argument whether or not the bread used for communion should be leavened or unleavened? A debate was over unleavened bread sounds like Jewish tradition. So if you really needed to, if you felt like you needed a hard break from Judaism, then it had to be leavened bread, because if you were using unleavened bread, then you were trying to be Jewish. So that's kind of, you know, people would have a hard divide against this. And so
the Last Supper, they just had regular bread, right?
At the Last Supper, being Passover, it would have been unleavened bread.
Oh, okay.
So you can see where the divide would be. So actually, because they refused to serve unleavened bread to this particular crowd, though, it caused a riot. And so people rose up, and everything was a mess. And so the council asked Farrell and Calvin both to leave Geneva. Farrell got an invitation to lead a church, and I have no idea how to say Nucatel. I'll just say it like that. And Calvin was invited to lead a church of French refugees in Strasbourg, which, if you remember, 2 years early, that's where he wanted to go anyway. And so he got an invitation to go there. And so by September of 1538, Calvin had taken up his new position in Strasbourg, fully expecting that this time would be permanent. You know, I'm where I wanted to be, and so I'm going to be here forever. And he applied for and was granted citizenship in Strasbourg. So here he is. Finally in Strasbourg, where he wants to be. He spent about 3 years in Strasbourg, and these were the happiest years of his life. He loved every minute of it. And so, you know, people were friendly to him, and he was able to preach. He preached every Sunday at St. Nicholas Church, and he publishes the second revision of the Institutes. If you remember, the first version that he, you know, that spread widely and kind of thrust him into the spotlight a little bit, it was 6 chapters long. Well, the second edition now is 17 chapters long. So, you know, he has a little more to say now. He publishes a commentary on Romans in 1540. And then also in 1540, he marries Adelette de Bure. Now, Adelette was married before and had two children. She was married to an Anabaptist preacher. You remember we talked about the Anabaptists a couple of weeks ago. And so she was married to an Anabaptist preacher who had died, passed away. And so she was widowed. And he actually died in a plague is how he had passed away. And so she was left with two sons. In 1541, representatives from Geneva came to Strasbourg, and they told John that the city council would like him to come back to Geneva. Now, he had two of the most miserable years of his life, followed by three of the happiest years in his life. What do you think the chances are that he's going to go back to Geneva? He's not really fond of the idea. But, he actually wrote this. He said, "Rather would I submit to death 100 times than to that cross on which I had to perish daily 1,000 times over." So it's like, I'm not going back there. Apparently, though, the libertines had kind of been silenced during that time, or maybe expelled, and so that was the church was kind of in decline, and so the city council really thought, we need someone like Calvin to really come and revitalize the church, and so they worked on him pretty hard. Finally, enough pressure was put on Calvin by Verret and by Farrell and the Geneva City Council. His pastoral mentor in Strasbourg, we didn't really get into that, but when, you know, John wasn't really much of a preacher. He was more of a writer. And so he had a mentor in Strasbourg that really helped him develop his oratory skills. Obviously, he was pretty good naturally because of the incident we talked about. But so his pastoral mentor really worked on him, saying, you know, hey, this feels like God's will. And then the final straw was Adelette really felt like, John, I believe this is God's will for us to go to Geneva. And he's like, but you haven't been there. You have no idea. But he relented, and so he went, and he agreed to be on loan to Geneva for 6 months. So I've heard the adage before, anybody can wrestle a bear for a little while, right? And so he thought, you know, okay, I'll go for 6 months, and maybe I can make a difference there. So he returned on September 13th, 1541, with an official escort and a wagon. They actually sent a military escort to help bring him back, maybe so he wouldn't change his mind. I don't know. But they, you know, moved him over and got him to Geneva. So he's back in Geneva, and the church in Geneva was clearly dedicated to reform, but it was really in chaos. There was really no clear structure, no leadership at the time. And so he came in, and so 2 months after he arrived, he got the city council to pass four ordinances that defines the orders of ministerial function. So the four orders were pastors to preach and to administer the sacraments, doctors to instruct believers in faith, elders to provide discipline, and deacons to care for the poor and the needy. And so this was kind of the structure that he made to minister to the people. The church at which, I mean, obviously he didn't make it up. You see this in the first century church, right? But the church had developed a form of democracy to govern itself in contrast to the authority and structure of the Catholic Church. Remember, the Catholic Church was all about, you know, the Pope says this and the Cardinal says this, and if you don't do it, you're excommunicated or burned at the stake. That was kind of that. So they erred 180 degrees off of that, which was, we'll just do whatever we feel like doing. You know, so John Calvin was kind of in the middle. It's like, nah, we can't be all the way over here, but we're not going to go all the way over here either. And so he set up a hierarchical structure to provide order, but the authority was in the office, not in the person. You see the difference. So the pastor had authority, but Pastor Bob, that sounds like a good 16th century name. Pastor Bob wasn't the one. It was the office of the pastor that had the authority. And so this was set up by John. He also set up a court that could judge ecclesiastical matters, having no civil jurisdiction. And so they could try cases, and the highest penalty that they could, or highest penalty that they could exact on somebody was excommunication. Nothing more than that. So, you know, he made sure, you know, we're not going to be burning people at the stake. We're just going to go, you know, we'll kick you out of the church, and that's about it. Well, that worked for a little while, but the city council finally pulled back on that and said, no, you know, we'll do all sentencing from the council level. Just a little bit of the activity while he was in Geneva in 1542. In 1542, he published a service book, which was a kind of a rework of one that he had published in Strasbourg, but reworked it a little bit for Geneva. And it contained prayers and hymns. He was really big on music. And so he used some of the hymns that he had borrowed from Martin Luther, because Martin Luther had written some hymns and also composed some of his own. And so he was big on singing in the church and good preaching. It's said that he preached over 2,000 sermons while in Geneva. It may have even been a lot more than that, because I was kind of putting the numbers to it. But he preached twice on Sunday, and at first he was preaching 3 days a week after the twice on Sunday, but it got to be a little burden for him, and so he went back to just preaching once on Sunday. And then later they came back and told him that they needed him to preach during the week. So he preached once on Sunday and then once each of the rest of the days of the week. So basically every day he was preaching. He preached for an hour, just like the what we talked about before. I guess that was just, he felt like preaching for an hour is how much he could talk at once. But he used no notes. He would preach. He would recite scripture. All of this just rolled off of his tongue, and would keep people really engaged in his sermons for these hours. And it wasn't really till 1949 that a scribe was assigned. I guess at some point they said, you know, somebody ought to be writing this stuff down. And so they hired a scribe who, and you'll appreciate this, invented a method of shorthand so that he could take notes from the sermon. And so I say that because I know, you know, you used to, anyway, as a secretary, use shorthand. Well, in 1949, Adelaide fell ill and died. Calvin never married again. He expressed his sorrow in a letter to Verrett that said, "I've been bereaved of the best friend of my life, of one who, if it has been so ordained, would willingly have shared not only my poverty, but also my death. During her life, she was the faithful helper of my ministry. From her, I never experienced the slightest hindrance." And so he really, you know, he leaned on her a lot, and apparently he's still in Geneva, which, you know, he didn't want to be there, but she probably had a lot to do with that as well. They only had one son who had been born premature and died in 1942, so he had no heirs to go on after him.
You said 1942.
And that's what my notes said, but I guarantee it wasn't 1942. I bet it was 1542. Although the Libertines had been minimized, I mean, they were still there, and so there was still some of that influence there, and they hated John Calvin. As a matter of fact, they did everything they could at every turn to try to cause trouble, especially because of his insistence that Christians must live moral lives. I mean, who believes this stuff, right? And so, how many of you know the spirit of the Libertines is still alive and well in 2022? In 1552, a man named Jacques Gruet was arrested for conspiring to kill John Calvin, and he was one of the ringleaders of the Libertines, and he was tried, convicted, and executed. Calvin was grieved that really the attention had come to this, you know, that because people were out to get him, it had caused this type of thing. And so he resigned, and the city council refused his resignation and said, "Yeah, you can't quit." And so he had to stay on. We're going to talk about now a guy named Michael Servetus. Michael Servetus was actually born the same year as John Calvin. They grew up in a lot of the same areas. They went to the same college. They were both at the University in Paris together for a while. Excuse me. And he was a brilliant man, well-educated, and excelled in everything that he studied. He had served in the court of France's Charles V. And I say that because, you know, there's a Charles V that was in the Holy Roman Empire, so I was making that distinction there. He was open in his attacks against the Pope, so he wasn't afraid to levy charges there, so that didn't make him very popular. But in 1531... he published a work called On the Errors of the Trinity, where he took on how traditional views of the Trinity that dated back to the Council of Nicaea, he seemed to be on the same thought of Arius. You remember Arius, the Santa Claus slapped. And so he was kind of that same thought in theology, and which is basically there's only one God, which we believe in one God, but they don't believe in the Trinity. They believe there's one God. So Jesus was actually a created being by God, and the Holy Spirit is much the same. And so, you know, there is no Trinity. And so this is what he was kind of resurrecting in some of his writings. He also taught in the University of Paris for a while and set up a medical practice after that. So he excelled in a lot of the things that he did. He began correspondence with John Calvin. They wrote back and forth for about 3 years. Actually, he wrote to John Calvin, I can't remember, it was like a wild number of letters before John Calvin decided, you know, I just need to answer this guy or he's not going to leave me alone. And so they corresponded for just a little bit. It was cordial at first until the tone of the letters started getting ramping up just a little bit. You know, you knew it was kind of becoming a heated battle over this theology. And John Calvin realized that it wasn't inquiries that Michael Servetus had. It was actually he was trying to sway John Calvin. And so John Calvin just broke off the correspondence and didn't write him back. A few years later, 1553, Servetus publishes a work that attacks the Trinity and slanders John Calvin. And so France, of course, was firmly Catholic at this time. And so Catholic is firmly Trinity. That's one of the things they get right. And so, therefore, Michael Servetus was arrested and was tried and convicted, and they decided that his punishment was to be burned at the stake. No surprise there, right? But an added twist of he was to be burned at the stake slowly. So, I mean, they really hated him. They spit or something, I don't know. And so, anyway, and then they were going to burn all his books with him. And so, while he was awaiting on carrying out of the sentence, the libertines in Geneva caught wind of this, and so a few well-placed bribes later, he escaped from prison and ended up in Geneva. And so the burning went forward, but just without Servetus. They just burned all his books. But he escapes to Geneva. And, of course, Geneva is a refugee city. You know, there's a lot of these French refugees who have come to Switzerland to escape the oppression there against especially reformers. And so Servetus goes up again to the city council, and the city council says, you can stay here as a refugee as long as you don't attack the Trinity and you don't attack John Calvin. Don't cross those lines and we're all cool. And so that worked for a little while until, what do you think happened?
They met each other in the street.
Not exactly. But he did start preaching against the Trinity, and he did start levying charges against John Calvin. And so he broke the rules. You know, you only had two rules. You couldn't hold those rules. And so they arrested him and they tried him. And people were bouncing things off of John Calvin, but just to be clear, John Calvin had nothing to do with the trial. He had nothing to do with the arrest. He was actually out of all that. And I say all this because, and not that I'm trying to be a big defender of John Calvin, but we want to be accurate. And there's a lot of people that are against Calvin that'll say, well, you know, if he's so great, why did he have Michael Servetus burned at the stake? That's not exactly how it happened, and so that's why I'm going through this, because you may hear that argument sometime. And John Calvin actually wrote to the city council, because remember we talked about last time that he was against this, crucifixions and burning at the stake, and he was against these types of punishment as a way to maintain order. And so he actually wrote to the city council saying not to burn him at the stake, but, you know, they did anyway. The final years of John Calvin, after the Servetus incident, the libertines basically faded away. So you don't hear a lot more about them until 2022. In 1555, there were many English refugees started showing up in Geneva. And we're going to talk about this a little bit next week, all right? But they were fleeing the Protestant persecution in England under the reign of
Henry VIII.
A little bit after Henry VIII.
Bloody Mary
Tudor. Very good. So we're going to cover that just ahead, so we won't get into that, but this is really the beginning of the Puritan Puritan movement. And so what does that sound like we're kind of getting close to? So we're going to be talking about Christians going to America soon. So we're going to talk about the Puritans a little bit more next week. So be sure you're here for that. Calvin trained and sent 100 missionaries to France. And, he's from France, and he had a burden for France. And so he trained and equipped these missionaries and sent them to France to really bolster the Reformation movement that was kind of going on underground. Does anybody know what the Protestants in France were known as?
Huguenots,
very good. And so the Huguenots, we're probably not going to get a lot into that, so just to warn you, but just to kind of give you just a little broad brush here, the movement grew until it eventually erupted into what is known as the French Wars of Religion, and it lasted about 35 years until 1598, and so it was a long war between the Reformed and the Catholic side. The population of the Huguenots continued to grow until they were nearly a million strong. Some say like 800, 900,000, something like that, until 1681. Louis the 14th launched a persecution against them until their number was under 2,000. And so, you know, there's a lot that was happening in France as well. I'll see as everything lays out if I want to get deeper into that. But basically during that time, it was, you either convert to Catholicism or be killed, you know, your choice. And so, Calvin continued with many reforms in Geneva until his death in 1564 at the age of 54. And so there's a lot more we could talk about him and things that he set in. There's forms of government that he kind of designed, if you will, that actually people look back and say, hey, America may have been actually discovered by John Calvin because of some of the things that he wrote and his style of or ideas of government was eventually translated to America. So we're going to leave some of that behind. But I want to look at one thing in the theology, but what is the theology most commonly associated with John Calvin? Predestination. Very good. Reformed theology or Calvinism is often defined by the acronym TULIP. Y'all ever heard that? We're going to get into this, but not today. The reason we're not going to get into this today, first of all of Reformed theology, these points of Reformed theology did not originate with John Calvin. A lot of these were actually developed after the death of Calvin. And the acronym TULIP came about in the 1900s. So why do you think it is that TULIP wouldn't have been used in 16th century Geneva? TULIP is an English word. And so they wouldn't have used that for the acronym anyway. But anyway, so that's a mnemonic device that helps us in the 20th and 21st centuries to understand Reformed theology. But I just brought that up just because that's the way we think about it, but that's not from back then. So obviously Calvin, being French, you know, teaching from a Swiss city of Geneva, would have not used the English word to define his thoughts. Predestination theology did not originate with Calvin. Actually, Augustine wrote about it some. And so you even notice how many of you read your Bible from time to time? Have you ever read in the New Testament, in the epistles, and you see the word predestination or the word chosen and things like that? And so it's in there, right? So if it's in there, it's worth talking about it. So there are writers, even back to Augustine, that would write about this and have things to say about it. So Calvin himself didn't spell out all the expressions that would later become what is today called Calvinism. But Calvin's successor, which is Theodore Beza, restructured many of Calvin's ideas after Calvin's death, and the core principles of Reformed theology were further defined in the Synod of Dort, and we'll get to that in about 2 weeks, in 1619. Some even levy say that John Calvin wouldn't have even been a Calvinist, because a lot of his ideas kind of took its own path after he died. And so that's to be debatable, I don't know, but it's interesting nonetheless. So we're going to talk about the doctrine of predestination in two different bites. Today, we're just going to talk about, as it relates to Calvin and the roots and kind of where that got started, and then we're not really going to talk as much about the rebuttals of predestination for a couple of weeks, because then there's a guy by the name of Jacobus Arminius, which is the man that Arminian theology came from. And so he's the one that crafted the rebuttals against predestination. And so we'll talk about all of that then, okay? Actually, Calvin wasn't that far off of what Luther believed. Luther didn't talk much about the subject of predestination, much as his focus was squarely on the grace and justification. You know, we talked about that a couple of different nights when we were in the discussion of Luther. Calvin and Luther both taught that man is dead in sin and in needing of saving. This salvation comes through the work of Jesus Christ and none of the works of man. Therefore, they would distance themselves from any language that sounded like we did something to save ourselves. And they were very opposed to making it sound like we did anything, because we had nothing to do with our own salvation. It was God that did the saving through Jesus Christ. All reformers hold to the idea of an unmerited grace, and we are called by God. He chose us. And really, a surface glance, if you look at a lot of scriptures, you know, you'd see some scriptures like John 15:16, you did not choose me, but I chose you. Ephesians 1:4-5 says, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, we should be holy and blameless before him in love. He predestined us for adoption to himself as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will. Actually, Ephesians chapter 1, it uses the word predestination quite a few times. And so you can look at these things and say, well, okay, so what about this? The base argument is rooted in really, what is God sovereign over? Okay, and another way to ask the question would be this. Who moves first? So we're going to talk about that just a little bit. So if Fred, if he's living a life of sin, he hears the gospel message, he believes, and he turns his life around and he lives for Jesus, did Fred invite Jesus into his heart and then God moved in response, or did God give him the ears to hear and pull him in and save him with no beginning action of John? John actually responded to the pull of God rather than the other way around. So that's the question, who moves first? And I think that your minds are probably already working where we're going to be going in this, because I'm not going to spoil it. Let's talk about Luther versus Calvin just a little bit before we answer that question. Luther wrestled with all the things that he had to do to make God love him. You remember where he would just, you know, beat himself, and he would confession for hours and hours and hours, because, you know, he felt like, you know, I've got to be worthy for God to love me. And so this was part of his monastic life that he was trained in. And so when he came to the realization and had his moment with Romans, where he realized, hey, you know, it's through grace and through faith that I'm saved, and I don't have to do all these things. That's really what turned him around. And so he wanted to distance himself from all of that. In Luther's writings, he does seem to embrace the doctrine of predestination, although modern Lutheranism, they would say that they do not believe in predestination and they reject that teaching altogether. Calvin addresses predestination in a lot of the same ways that Luther does. His first issue, when Fred is converted, do we say that he is called upon God and God has responded, or do we say that it is God who has given him ears to hear and rescued him from sin? Calvin would say that God was at work trying to bring us to salvation long before we were even aware of it. And without that, we would not even have the opportunity to respond in the first place. So there's parts of that we would agree with. That's exactly what we believe. So where do they differ? Luther, late in his life, he wrote, I hear that here and there among the nobles and persons of importance, vicious statements that if I am predestined, I shall be saved whether I do good or evil. If I am not predestined, I shall be condemned regardless of my works. And so it sounds like, from our vantage point looking back, that Calvin's kind of, you know, like casting this dispersion against John Calvin a little bit. That's not really the case. He wasn't really addressing Calvin in this, but some of the things that he was hearing, people were saying, you know, well, you know, if I'm predestined to go to heaven, so to speak, or to be chosen of God, then it doesn't really matter what I do. Kind of like the libertines. And so Martin Luther is pushing back against this. Of course it matters what you do. You know, he actually absolutely rejects the thought that, you know, if I'm predestined, then I'm saved whether I do good or evil. He pushes back against that. He feels the doctrine of predestination has grown out of its proper place, and predestination taken too far makes the person irrelevant and what we do unimportant. And so, you know, in his view, he was going at it from a service, as a pastor, going through the service end of things. Okay, you view that way about predestination, then there's no need in you to take the sacrament. There's no need in you to listen to preaching. There's no need in you to even attend a church service, right? Because you're predestined to go to heaven or to be called of God. Calvin teaches predestination in a lot the same ways as Luther, but Luther was more guarded about how much he talked about it. Calvin wasn't really, he wasn't afraid to talk about anything. He would just dive into it and felt like, you know, hey, if it's in the Bible, then hey, let's talk about it. And he would write extensively about it. He wrote about the reprobate. He talked about the reprobate as those for some reason God decided to pass over. And these are people that, you know, God just decided, I'm not going to save them. And he talks about God's elect and the ones that God has chosen. He also focuses on Romans 9:13, as it is written, Jacob I loved, but Esau I hated. And so, you know, we're not going to get into all the theology of that. But, you know, he really pondered this question, said, well, you know, see, God chose Jacob and he rejected Esau. And, of course, you know, we could make a whole sermon about that. And so Calvin would dive into these questions. So that's really the difference between Calvin and Luther, is that he's not afraid to tackle these issues, whereas Luther would, you know, he kind of stayed on grace and justification. So there's a question now that we need to answer. And this is relevant to the question or the doctrine of predestination. Is faith a work? When we're talking about Martin Luther, you know, we were talking about faith and grace and justification and how we're saved by faith, not by works, right?
Faith is believing.
Okay, faith is believing, but is that faith a work? So we're not going to go into a full-scale rebuttal of Calvinism right now, but I do want to look at a couple of scriptures that addresses this question. In Romans 4:5, it says, and to the one who does not work but believes in him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is counted as righteousness. So when you look at this, you see two sides of this, right? Not work, so it's not works, right? But believes. So clearly Paul's not saying that belief or that faith is a work, because it's not by works, but he who believes. And so we see a contrast there that Paul's not equating faith or not equating belief to a work. The argument that props up Calvinism is that we aren't saved by works, and our calling of the Lord is a work. Paul makes this distinction here that it's the faith of the one who believes that is justified, not the one who works. And so it's clear that he doesn't equate the two. One more. Paul gives foundation and finality starting in verse 13, just a little bit lower. For the promise to Abraham and his offspring that he would be heir of the world did not come through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. For it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs. Faith is null and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, there is no transgression. That is why it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his offspring, not only to the adherent of the law, but also to the one who shares the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. So Abraham received the promise, right, because of his righteousness. And, you know, in Hebrews, we see that the faith of Abraham did what? It was accounted to him as righteousness. Okay, so the law came through that, you know, Abraham, then Moses, and God gave the law to Moses. But the law wasn't what saved them, was it? And usually when the writers of the epistles are talking about works, except for James, but many of them are talking about, especially Paul, when he's talking about works, he's talking about the Jewish people doing the law. And that's what he's calling works. And so Paul's saying that we're not saved through works. Works actually, or the law actually, shows us what sin is. So through the law, we see what sin is, but doing the law, performing the law, isn't what brings you to righteousness, but it's faith that brings you to righteousness. And so you can see Paul's not saying that faith is a work. Faith is the other side of the scale, so to speak, of works. So you have works and you have the law over here. You have faith and you have grace over here. So faith and our calling upon God is not a work, but it's actually the opposite of that work. Galatians 2:16, it says, "Yet we know that a person is not justified by the works of the law, but through faith in Jesus Christ. So we also have believed in Christ Jesus in order to be justified by faith in Christ and not by works of the law, because by works of the law, no one will be justified." So that is backing up what I just said. The law is not what justifies us. We can't be righteous by the law. We are righteous through faith, for believing in Christ Jesus in order to be justified. And so we have to have that act. We have to do something. I know it, you know, goes against people that says, you know, there can't be any works involved. But Paul's saying the doing something of believing and having faith, that's not a work, but it's a requirement in order to be justified. Paul had previously wrote to the Galatians with the same theme, giving a clear distinction between works and faith. So we believe in Jesus in order to be justified by faith. So our faith depends on our belief. So what about the question of who moved first that we talked about? 1 John 4:19. It says, "We love because he first loved us." Who moved first? God moved first. 1 John 4:9. "In this, the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him." We could even throw in Romans 5:8 there, couldn't we? God showed his love through us in that while we were yet sinners. Oh, is that what you just said? So we see that, you know, humans messed up. Basically, the story of the Bible is humans messed up. God moved first to rescue man. Can we come to God without an action by God himself? The scripture says, no one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him. So Jesus said, no one can even come unless the Father draws first. And so God has to move first, right? And God has moved first. So Jesus' words are clear that it takes an action of the Father first before we can come to him. So who does God call, I guess, is the question. And that's really the root of predestination.
He's calling everybody.
Does he call everybody, or does he just call the elect?
It's not his will that any should perish.
Okay. So this is part where the theology really divides, and what you say is this. So who does God call? We would say this, and that's exactly where you went. "The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient toward you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should receive or reach repentance." Now, I'll just go ahead and tell you, the Reformed theologian is going to say, "Oh, you people, you always go to that scripture." But that's not really what it means in context. And so, you know, this is, you know, if you have an argument with someone that believes in predestination, they're going to have an answer for this. But just because God doesn't want any to perish, they'll say, doesn't mean that he doesn't still only choose certain ones to be saved. Well, yes, it does. I would say. The verse in context gives us a glimpse at the character of God. It was written by Peter, who spent 3.5 years with Emmanuel, God with us, right? So he should know the character of God. He should be able to relay the character of God because he walked with God. He talked with God in the flesh. And so Peter's addressing scoffers, saying that the promise isn't coming because they don't see it. And that's why, if you kind of go up to verse 1 there, people are saying that, hey, you know, we've heard this all of our lives. How many of you have heard Jesus coming back all your life? Okay, they were even saying it back then. You guys, you're always preaching that Jesus is coming back. We've heard that, and we just don't believe it's true because we haven't seen it. And he's saying, you know, God's not slow concerning his promise, but he's not willing. He's saying God is patient because he wants more people to come into the kingdom. And I don't believe that if you wanted to make the case that, well, see, you know, God's wanting to delay so that the elect can come. I mean, if it was that cut and dry and he was drawing just certain ones, you would think that that would happen at his pace, right? Instead of saying, okay, I'm waiting for more people to come to me. So we're going to spend some more time on this later, but I just want to leave with Romans 10:13. Somebody already said this. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. It doesn't seem like that says everyone who God picked out ahead of everybody else. It says everyone. Anyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved.